The hottest t-shirts to hit the internet. Online now. Fat Guy Radio Show swag merch store at fatguyradioshow.com/store. T-shirt styles and designs for everyone. Show your love for the show or rock a killer swanky new tee designed by us. Visit fatguyradioshow.com/store. Starting at just $19.99. Choose your size and color, then buy it now to order. 100% satisfaction guaranteed. Shipping worldwide. Order today as supplies are limited. The Fat Guy Radio Show swag merch store. Open now at fatguyradioshow.com/store.
Folks gobbling up those McRibs. You know they're back. I just had my fourth one. And people are worried about what's in the vaccine. Maybe we should be more worried about what's in this succulent, sauce-drenched, gummy, alien Zuckerberg baby meat we call the McRib. It's delicious, though. Oh, yeah, this is Fat Guy Radio Show Snackable. Well, welcome to Fat Guy Radio Show Snackable, a mini-series of one-on-one shows with me, your boy, Corey Blaze. A new YouTube series of shows because clearly I don't have enough to do. The show is done in segments. I make them up as I go. If you know the words, feel free. Let's dive in and get it started with one of my fat fake takes. Okay, look, today's November 15th, right? Today's November 15th, and I haven't even, like, given a second thought to Thanksgiving dinner or what I'm going to eat for Thanksgiving. I'm not having the family over. I lost my family in the tragedy of 2018 or whenever the hell that was. So it's just me. The kids are doing, you know, they're off on their own lives and you know, out there COVID sucking. So I'll probably be, you know, one plate Thanksgiving, but I haven't even thought about it. With all of the like prices in grocery stores right now, I mean, Thanksgiving dinner for one will probably run me somewhere around $4,000. I don't know, but when I was prepping for the show on the way in, I was thinking about like picky eaters. Back when I did do Thanksgiving for a large group, you know, like, you know, family and friends and stuff like that, I thought about, you know, I used to have picky eaters. I'm like, I don't want this. I don't want that. I don't want onions. My middle child, Aiden, is one of those picky eaters. AJ is one as well. But Aiden is like one of the ones that will go to me. He's like, I love him to death. I love the little boy. And he's grown out of it a little bit. But he was one of the little kids that you would take to McDonald's. He would get a double cheeseburger. But the kid didn't like cheese and onions. And if you don't know, the double cheeseburger at McDonald's comes with cheese and onions. Why do you order it? I'm like, okay, well then why don't you just get a plain hamburger? No, I want. It's like he craved the remnants of cheese. I don't know, but he was one of those like picky eaters that would avoid cheese and onions at all cost. You know what I mean? And I was thinking about this. I mean, my kids were lucky. I would of course order the double cheeseburger with no cheese and no onions. I would. You know, because I want to be a good role model, spoiling them. But when I was a young warthog, when I was knee high to a grasshopper, I didn't have that luxury. Grandma Blaze was not taking you out to eat, number one, and she sure as hell wasn't cooking a dinner or a lunch or a breakfast with your taste buds in mind. Whatever Grandma Blaze cooked, she served. If there was something in it you didn't like, your ass didn't eat. Black-eyed peas. My grandmother would make a big pot of black-eyed peas in a heartbeat. Some people didn't like black-eyed peas. Some people didn't like the onions she put in them. One time, grandma even put okra in black-eyed peas. Don't ask me how, but she did. And cousin didn't like okra. Guess what happened? Them fools didn't eat. When I was growing up, there was none of this, I don't like this food, I don't want to eat this food. You either ate what was served in front of you, or your ass went hungry. I didn't have the luxury of picking and choosing certain foods. Now, there is one ingredient in my adult life that I don't particularly care for, and that's mustard. You know, like Guy Fieri, you know, famous Food Network chef. He has one thing that's his what's that Superman thing? Kryptonite. His kryptonite are eggs, but he'll eat an egg. He'll eat something that's been drenched in egg. I'm the same way with mustard. I'm not going to go up to a mustard bottle and just squirt the whole thing in my mouth. I'm not going to do that. Hell no, lady. I'm not going to do that. But if I have like a burger and there's mustard on the burger, then I'll have that burger. Or if I have a rack of ribs and it's been rubbed with mustard and then a dry rub put on top of it, I will eat those ribs, even though there's mustard involved in it. But I've never, ever racking my brain back. I'd never had the luxury of saying I didn't want something. And that's probably why it leads to the fact that why I don't do group orders anymore. Like if I'm going to, you know how when you're like working in an office space, you know, prior to the pandemic when we were all civilized, you'd be working in an office space and you'd have that you buy, I'll fly type of situation. And then you got your little sticky note and you're running around your office getting everybody's order. And then you got that you got that one idiot that's like, yes, I want 2.7 ounces of tomato, 3.9 ounces of mayo. I want half wheat, half white, half rye, half sourdough bread. I need my lettuce only on the right. I need my pickles only on the left. And I need any meat to be folded at a 47.99 degree angle. That person that got so specific, knowing damn well when your ass was going to the sandwich shop to pick up lunch for everybody, there was no way that the 15-year-old behind the counter putting that sandwich together was going to get all that right. And then what'd you have to do? You had to go back to the office and just say, ah, man, it's on me. Don't eat it. Or, oh, man, I spent your money. I'm sorry they didn't get it right. And then they walking around frowning at you. That's my childhood of not being able to have the luxury of being a picky eater is probably why I don't like doing that. You eat it the way it comes off the menu. Because when I was growing up, you ate it the way it was served. You didn't have a choice. That's what it was. That's what it was going to be. And you either took it or you left it. There wasn't no, oh, grandma, make me some without eggs or make me some without onions. No, Grandma Blaze look at you upside down your head. You ain't eating, baby. Gone with God. You was not eating. Picky eaters. Oh, and one other thing. I believe that what Grandma Blaze was doing was really cathartic to what I have to my adult palate today. Because what I have is I'm open to trying new foods, new things. I won't shy away from something because I'm not familiar with it. I've had alligator. I've had snake. I've had squirrel. I've had turtle, frog legs, rabbit. All those things that people normally don't eat, I've had because it's like, you know what? I've never had it before, but I wasn't a picky. I didn't have the luxury of being a picky eater when I was young. So I'm going to eat this in front of me. And I'm going to try it. I may like it. You never know. Grandma knew what was going on back in the day, and everybody else these days just playing around. All right, let's transition with a baby pushing his older brother down a hallway into a door. Okay, God bless the people that run the New York City Marathon. That happened, what, just a couple of weeks ago was the New York City Marathon? Okay, look. God bless those people. It was back for the first time this year due to the pandemic. Last year, they canceled it. No one was able to do it. But I'm watching this, and I know it's shocking to you that I'm not, you know, a physically fit person. I know. Don't try to adjust your computer screens. I'm fat. I get this. New York City Marathon. Okay, fine. You want to run down the city. New York's beautiful from what I know. Never been there. Would love to go someday. You want to run. So a couple of people that I follow on social media ran the New York City Marathon. And I'm looking at their social media's pages after the marathon. And one host of the Sports Junkies in D.C., Washington, D.C., John Paul Flame, posted a picture, this picture, on his Twitter of him laying in a hospital bed, okay, with oxygen, and he's got, I guess, the medal from running the New York City Marathon, and he had the caption, ups and downs of the New York City Marathon. You went and voluntarily ran down the streets of New York and you ended up in the hospital. Okay. Okay, maybe John Paul was just a little out of shape. I don't know. But then I'm watching Inside Edition, and look at this guy. This poor bastard. This dude is being held up by two other runners because his legs gave out on him. He bit the dust. These two runners were close to the finish line. This guy's name is Jamel Melville. His legs gave out from under him, and he was, I guess, within a short distance of the finish line, and two runners had to stop to help him get to the finish line. Dude, fine. So then I start digging. Now I'm all in. Now I'm all invested. I'm like, this New York City Marathon is a man killer. What the hell is happening here? I understand it was canceled last year because of the pandemic. This is insane. So then I looked it up. New York City Marathon problems. Bleeding nipples. I'll let you have that one for a moment. Bleeding nipples. Nipple bleeds. They have to tape up their nips. Guys and girls, all the runners have to tape up their nips. I'm like, what the hell is bloody nipples? And then I clicked on an article from runnersworld.com where they had an article that said how to prevent bloody nipples. And I guess it's something that you get when you're a distance runner. Your nipples start to bleed because your nipples are, I guess, moving. I don't know. I don't run unless it's an ice cream truck. I guess your nipples are moving for a long period of time where they run up against your shirt and you start to bleed. They chafe to the point where they bleed. Are you serious with this? What's the point of running a marathon? New York, not just a New York City marathon. We have marathons here in Arizona and people run. They don't do them during the summer because then they start the marathon and then everybody be rushed to the hospital within 15 minutes of running a marathon in the middle of an Arizona summer. There's the Boston City Marathon. What's the point in running a marathon if you're going to have to go through this where you could possibly end up in the hospital, possibly having to be carried to the finish line, or your nipples start bleeding? What do you get? Like, is there a prize? Is there money? What? Do you get your picture in the paper? You get a little participation medal? For what? For what? I'm all fine for people that want to be health fanatics. That's fine. That's all great. You want to go running around the park. That's cool. You're running a marathon that's miles long. Your nipples are bleeding. Your legs give out on you and you can't breathe. It sounds like something I'd want to sign me up. What the hell? What's the benefit of it? If you know, leave it in the comments below. What's the benefit of a New York City marathon? Or a marathon, unless it's like raising money for something. I mean, I know we have like the Susan G. Komen walk here. We have the breast cancer walk. You know, I understand people pay and that money goes to those types of things. Is the New York City Marathon tied to like one of those things? I don't know. And if I honestly don't know. But these people are subjecting themselves to what seems to be some pretty traumatic things. Get a little medal is there like $1 million prize or something? There's thousands of people that run this thing. I don't know. All right. I got one more fat fake take for you. Let's transition with a kid licking his baby sibling. Month of November, and there is this thing, this hashtag that comes around every year. We're probably going to have to do some bleeping here. No Nut November. It's pretty much, you know, a challenge to, I mean, I guess it could be everybody. It doesn't have to just be a guy. Basically, you don't have a sexual encounter to completion. So that's why it's called No Nut November. And idiots are trying it. It's all over social media. I don't think it's something that's like real. I think it's just people just love using Hashtag no nut November. But I want to take it to a whole nother level for you. If you're following along at home, grab your pencils and papers, men and women, and track with me. I got the challenge. The challenge is no nut November, but how about if we take it to the next level? How about no December? No Jack January? No fapping February? No mashing March? No ass April? No self-love making May? No jerking June? This was my favorite. No Johnson July? No arcing loads August? No spanking September? And no old face October? If you're gonna try to do this hashtag of no nut November challenge, just go the whole year. Save the world from your probability. Save the world from the probability of you procreating to have another human being that is going to try this stupid hashtag no nut November when they're able to get to that point in their human development. Let's go all the way with it. Do the rest of the months too. Just don't ever do it again. You'll be having hospitals lined up with people just mad, angry, frustrated, sexually charged up individuals. All right, folks, we got a new segment here for you. This one's called I Don't Wanna, But I'm Gonna. Okay, look, I don't want to get heavy. I don't like getting heavy on this. I really, really don't. But I'm going to make some really good points here, some bullet points. And we're going to move off of this and we're going to get to a TikTok video social what? Actually, not social what. You're crying. I'm not crying. That's coming up. All right. Listen, the Astro World tragedy. Horrible, horrible event that happened just a couple of weeks ago. The Astro World tragedy is as much of a misdirection as the tragedy on the Rust movie set. Hear me out. Hear me out. I'm not taking anything away from what happened and the lives that were lost a few weeks ago. My heart goes out to those people that have suffered any type of loss in these two particular situations. But this is not, I'm going to say it, this is not Astro World. What happened there is not Travis Scott's fault. Just like it's not Alec Baldwin's fault on what happened on the movie set of Rust. Why? What the media is doing is that they are tying the two biggest names to these tragedies that they can. And unfortunately, that's Travis Scott and Alec Baldwin. Because the media doesn't want to report on the failure of some third-party security detail that failed and led to someone's death. No, they rather give you a headline that says, entertainer Travis Scott kills concert goers. Or instead of a headline that says, prop master screws up and cinematographer shot dead on a movie set, they decide to give you a headline that says Alec Baldwin shoots cinematographer, which in itself is true, but they're not going to tell you that that's just the way that the media wants to sell it. They're selling that name. They're riding that name. I do it. I'm not going to give you a story that is Joe Schmo up the street that did the same thing that, I don't know, a celebrity would do. But listen, Travis, I'm going to break some things down for you because I work at these large arenas and I see how some of this works. So what is at the root of Travis Scott is that he is under the thumb of a record label. He's under the control of a record label. Alec Baldwin is under the control of whatever studio he's working for on whatever film project or TV project he is working on. Why the media puts their names out there is because they have very large names. The media is not going to tell you about the breakdown of the security company's fail. They want to tell you that it was Travis Scott's concert. Okay. Travis is not the only artist that has ruckus crowds at his concerts. Have you heard of a band called Iron Maiden, Slayer, Agnostic Front, Cro-Mags, Twisted Sister, or here's one, my personal favorite, Red Hot Chili Peppers? Now, what Travis Scott's concert has is no different than a concert that has like a mosh pit. There were 9 people trampled to death during a Pearl Jam concert in 2000. This isn't something new. And in that concert in 2000 where 9 people were trampled to death at the Pearl Jam, those deaths weren't Eddie Vedder's fault. These people are just actors and artists. They are not forcing anyone to like come to their show or come to their sets to work. What people don't realize is that there are many, many layers involved in any large attended group gathering. And I work for all these. I work for these places, arenas. I work for several arenas and a stadium. There are so many things. City regulations, approved city concert vendors, fire marshals, all the way down to the permit officials that license the venue's occupancy. Artists have nothing to do with that. Artist works for a record label or a concert promoter, and the record label and the concert promoter are the ones that are supposed to have the relationships with these venues, and these businesses entrust these business venues to ensure the safety of their artist and the safety of the attendees. That has nothing to do with the person with the microphone in their hand. It has nothing to do with the person that's acting in a role. There's so many more moving pieces that have to work in conjunction, in harmony, in order to pull off one of these large gatherings. It's not, the fire marshal can meet with Travis Scott all he wants, but Travis Scott has no control over making sure that this segment has this and this many people are over here and that many people over there. I know people on social media were like, well, if he just stopped the concert, that wouldn't have done anything. The damage had already been done. What, were they going to stop the concert and then say, okay, all 40,000 of you just shift 1 foot to the left? No, be realistic. That failure that happened at Astroworld was the failure of several layers of control that did not do what they were supposed to do. Let's look at the storming of the gate. Everybody, the media loves to show you that video over and over. How did that even happen? I work at State Farm Stadium. Okay, I would like to see, you know, a couple of hundred people try to storm State Farm Stadium's gates. Yeah, you're gonna make it through. You're probably gonna make it into the stadium. You're gonna make it into the seats, but I guarantee you, ain't no damn football game gonna happen. Ain't no concert or Super Bowl gonna happen. You're gonna have the Glendale police and probably the damn National Guard and MCSO all over your ass of people that storm the gate. There ain't no way the entertainment is going to go on because the powers that be in between you and whatever has happened at that stadium are going to step in and say, these MFers just stormed the gate. This show ain't happening until we get these people out. That's not Travis Barker's call. Just like at State Farm Stadium, that's not a football player's call to stop the show because somebody's stopped the game because somebody stormed the gates. Let me break it down to you even more. Travis Barker, when he's up on that stage, and Alec Baldwin, when he's on a movie set, they're at work. So if you're at work and let's say the printer stops working, that's not your fault. Just like it's not the fault of Travis Scott. I think I said Travis Barker earlier. Travis Scott and Alec Baldwin. These are tragedies, folks, but this is not on these names. The media is just giving you those names because those names grab. People want to know what's happening with Travis Scott. People want to know what's happening with Alec Baldwin. But when you have these large contingency of people, concert goers, concerts have been happening for years, hundreds of years, all the way back to the Roman days. It's like a game of Jenga. And all it takes is one piece of that game to falter or to be weak. And all the rest of the game is over. You get instances like Astroworld. You get instances like the Rust movie set. You get instances like Pearl Jam in 2000. You know what I mean? So it's like, I'm sorry this happened. It's sad. My heart goes out to those families. But don't let the media get you all twisted up saying that it's Travis and Alec's fault. Even Alec fired the deadly weapon. There were so many different layers of people and control checkpoints that failed before Alec even pulled that trigger during that rehearsal or whatever. The media will twist it up to you because they're artists and actors, just because their name is bigger than Joe Schmo, who forgot to turn his walkie-talkie on. All right, I'm done. Went a little longer than that. Okay, let's transition, ladies and gentlemen, to you're crying, I'm not crying. All right, here we go. Tell of the tape. Let's roll it.
Thank you for the happiest year of my life.
Aww, isn't that beautiful? Oh, okay. So what we have for those of you that are listening to this on audio and you're not listening and you're not watching this on YouTube, I implore you to go to YouTube and check this out. Subscribe while you're there. We have a father and son in the kitchen, both looking over a donut birthday cake with a single candle. I've done this. A single candle in the donut cake. And the father lights the candle, then goes to blow the candle out. And at the same time, his young son leans in and kisses his father on the forehead. Cue emotional music bed. Everybody's crying. Now, that was a beautiful and a special moment. Now I have to ruin it because that's what we do in this segment. Here's the thing. The mother is not part of this video. This guy's entire TikTok is about him being a single father. Congrats. I know the feeling. Okay. Here's the storyline behind the camera as I understand it, or as I have decided to make it up for your entertainment. The mother of this child had too many girls night outs with her girls. One fateful night, too many wine corks were popped, and the mother of the boy in this video had an awakening to some suppressed feelings. She tried to suppress those feelings deeper, but it got so bad she brought it up to her man, the boy's father. The idea of bringing another woman into their bedroom, to their boudoir, not right, not thinking straight. No thinking straight guy is gonna say no to that. If your girl came to you and said, "Hey, how about we invite another girl in?" You're not gonna say. So what happens is a relationship formed between the three, but the mom was more drawn towards the other woman's, finger quotations, enjoyment. And she left the guy, making him a single father and giving us these touching TikTok videos because the mom is now a full motorcycle leather wearing lesbian. That's probably not true, but I said it anyway. You can't give me these touching videos without me screwing them up for you. All right, ladies and gentlemen, that's been Fat Guy Radio Show Snackable. I hope you're enjoying these because I'm having a really good time putting these together. Make sure you murder. I want your mouse on your computer to explode as you click the subscribe button. Murder that bitch. Follow Fat Guy Radio Show on all social media, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, TikTok. With all of these videos that I talk about on Snackable and I talk about on Fat Guy Radio Show with Doug the DA Andrew and Daniel DT Taylor and every once in a while my little brother DJ Little D, we like those, so they show up in our like section on TikTok. So if you're ever missing or you want to see these videos on your own, or if you want to follow the people that we feature, they're in our like section. So go and check those out. Oh man, this has been fun. This has been a great one. I thank you so much again for subscribing to the YouTube page. If you haven't, please do so. Thank you to all of you that are watching these and commenting and forwarding them and sharing them. I really do appreciate that. Social media, smash all those follow and like buttons and spread the word about Fat Guy Radio Show on Thursday nights, typically at 7 p.m. And then always tune in and subscribe to the YouTube page for a new snackable every Monday morning at 8 a.m. Arizona time. I've been Corey Blaze. We will see you next time on Fat Guy Radio Show Snackable.